Good evening and welcome to UW Space Place. Tonight is another one of our guest lecture series on the second Tuesdays of the month. And tonight I'm very pleased to introduce Professor Alex Lazarian of the UW Astronomy Department. Alex is a worldwide known expert on astrophysical magnetic fields and has been honored, among other things, with a Humboldt Prize from the Humboldt Foundation in Germany. And he's here to talk to us tonight about interesting aspects of interstellar and intergalactic, and I don't know what else, magnetic fields. So join me in welcoming Professor Lazarian.
Thank you very much. I will be talking about magnetic fields in the universe. And here we see magnetic fields of the galaxy, and this is magnetic fields of a bar magnet. I'll start my lecture showing you an experiment which clarifies the importance of magnetic fields. For example, this is a magnet, this is a metallic tube. So, look, this is a normal magnet. Again. Why is that? Because magnetic field of this magnet induces currents in this tube, and the interaction of this currents and magnet makes the motion of slows down the motion of the magnet. I'll give this tube, and you may play while I'm giving the lecture. Just turn it to me later. Yes, it's copper. Right. So this is also a citation. Those whose restless minds study the world structure, search for the beginning of things, should inquire into the origin of a magnet. And this is the citation from an ancient Roman writer. So, in the university, we have particular installations which use magnetic fields to confined plasma. And I would claim that this is the future of energy industry, because this is the unlimited source of energy. And if we think about what the humanity was always limited by, it was energy. And this development would be as remarkable and as important, and even more important than the use of fire by human beings. But let's talk about history of magnets. Okay, lodestone was the first natural magnet, and it is presumably produced naturally during lightning, when we have iron ores in the earth and there is a lightning. Why it is called magnet? Well, it is from the place which called magnesia. And there are two theories where this magnesia was situated. One is that it was situated in the modern Turkey, and another is it was not probably far from Athens in Greece. But there, the first magnets were found and described by people. What were the first practical use of magnets? And we have actually two uses. One was by Chinese fortune tellers, and another is by Vikings. What were Chinese fortune tellers doing? They were putting a boat or in a bucket of water and would say, this is your destiny. And then they move this bucket of water, but the boat would still point in the same direction. This would be a very convincing way to persuade people that they have some magic powers, and for some limited sum of money, you can know what's your future. You can play with this and predict future this way by taking cork and having a magnetized needle, putting it, and you will see the same effect. What about the Vikings? Vikings were using them for seafaring, and they were actually a pest of Europe. And they would, for example, plunder Britain, and to get the quickest way to Britain, they needed some navigation. And they were using different navigation tools. Well, magnet was one of them. What do we know about strength of magnetic fields? We have really a big variety of magnetic field strength. For example, Earth magnetic field, you can say that a ballpark value is 1 Gauss. It's in fact 0.5 Gauss. But the magnetic fields in between the stars in the interstellar media is a million times less. Sunspot magnetic field, on the contrary, is 1,000 times more. But this is not the limit. In the laboratory, you can, in some explosion devices, reach magnetic fields which are 10 million times stronger than the Earth magnetic field. But this is essentially nothing compared to the magnetic fields of magnetars, which can be 10 to the 15 Gauss. And the scales are really of wide range. They can be a million or 10 million light years. So such a scale of magnetic fields. And I may mention to you already that the applications were fortune tellers in China. It's 200 BC, and the navigation by Vikings. The first description, detailed description of magnet and its properties is in the manuscript by Monk in 1269. And the first theory of magnetism was suggested by René Descartes. Descartes was a really remarkable man, and his Latin name is related to this Cartesian system of reference, because it was he who introduced it. At the same time, a particular discovery of his is not associated with his name. I can ask you, what is the measure of atmospheric pressure? And you answer to me, Pascals, because it was it is associated with Blaise Pascal. However, it was René Descartes who devised this experiment. The experiment was that you put mercury in a tube, go to the mountain and see the change of the level of the mercury, and this is the pressure of the atmosphere. It was devised by Descartes, but he did not have a small thing. Well, actually a big thing, a mountain. He was living in Holland. It's pretty flat. He couldn't make such an experiment. He could surely travel somewhere, but he thought, why no, I not write to my friend Pascal? And to describe, he's living exactly near the mountain. He did it. Well, Pascal performed all that Descartes was writing to him. Then he wrote his scientific paper, which had one small deficiency. He forgot to mention whose idea it was. Well, in any case, this is again the citation, and this is the portrait of Descartes. Well, Descartes actually was chosen to be a tutor of Swedish queen, who Christina, who comes to the throne at 19, was very active. And actually, this is the tragedy of Descartes, because here they become lovers. Well, you would say it's not a tragedy, but you know, Christina was 19 and he was a middle-aged man. And Christina was very active. She would dance till 2 with Descartes. And in the morning at 6 o'clock, she would wake him up to have for example, horse riding. And the guy got sick and he dies of pneumonia. Christina becomes very desperate. She abdicated very soon. She actually kept his head all with her. So only the body of Descartes was buried, and head was kept and preserved with Christina. Well, his theory surely was pretty naive. The actual theory of magnetism was suggested by James Clerk Maxwell. And these are the equations of Maxwell. Well, then it became some business. You have them on the mugs. And some students have them on tattoos and t-shirts. And this lady has it on the back. Probably it will help her fellows on the exam. What we have in astrophysics? In astrophysics, we have not only magnetic fields, but also we have ionized gas or plasma. And plasma and magnetic fields are inseparable in the case of astrophysical phenomena. Plasma follows magnetic fields, and magnetic fields follow gas. So they, I mean, plasma and magnetic fields behave this chord. It's if you move plasma, magnetic field is moving. With this device, we can explain many properties of magnetic fields. For example, we can explain how to increase the strength of magnetic field. Magnetic field strength is, in this case, maybe represented by the thickness of this cord. But what I'm doing now, I'm doing an experiment which is called Zeldovich dynamo. So I twist this band, then I fold, and I stretch. What do I have? I have twice the magnetic field. I can do this again and again and increase the strength of magnetic field. This is the way plasma, moving plasma, can enhance magnetic field and create magnetic fields. Magnetic fields that we see in the universe are not primordial. They are generated. The sun is generating magnetic field, and magnetic fields are related to plasma. The plasma activity magnetic activity is related to, for example, the solar spot. The solar spots are particular places. For example, this is a solar spot. This is also the solar spot. And these are places where magnetic fields are enhanced. And I will be telling a bit later that the number of the solar spots may be related to the temperatures that we experience on the Earth and to the Earth climate. So solar spots were discovered by Galileo, and they contain very intense magnetic field lines. These are actually spots that we see as dark. But if you bring the material of the solar spot in this room, it will be shining. It's just the relative temperature of the solar spot is less than the temperature of the ambient plasma. The size can be much larger than the size of our planet. And they actually contain very intensive magnetic fields, which are measured by Zeeman splitting. Solar spots present one example of magnetic activity. There are other examples. For example, these are arches, plasma arches we see. And they are formed also by magnetic field. Plasma is moving along magnetic fields. These air arches can be stable for some times, but then they can destabilize and eject high energy particles. And for example, here we see this arch prominence, and this is Earth for comparison. These are really huge events, and this is they are comparable to the size of the sun. These are examples of magnetic phenomena. These magnetic phenomena are related to ejection of energetic particles, and these energetic particles can create a lot of effects for us. Aurora is one of these effects, and this is an example of aurora. We can see different examples here. Some of them are called aurora australis in the southern hemisphere and aurora borealis in the northern hemisphere. This is our planet, and this is the aurora around the pole. I can also show you some of the pictures from the space station, from the International Space Station, as it, you see, flies, and you see this spectacular events. Another. What is the cause of them? You have energetic particles which interact with atmosphere. For example, red and green light are related to oxygen, atomic oxygen, and there can be blue light related to molecules. We see, for example, here mostly green light. Interestingly enough, this aurora can happen not only for our planet. The planets which have magnetic fields also experience similar events. And this is aurora at Jupiter. Even at Uranus, you have aurora. Well, the boundaries of aurora in the northern hemisphere are shown here. And they depend on the intensity of aurora. So, for example, this red line corresponds to most intensive aurora. Well, these are interesting, spectacular phenomena, and sometimes aurora can be so bright that you can read a newspaper at night. But it also can be pretty pernicious. And it's important to understand these events to, for example, save equipment on satellites. This is the subject of space weather. So the idea is very simple. You have generation of energetic particle by sun, and these particles then propagate towards the Earth. They're diffusing or moving together with the solar wind, and it gives us hours, around 18 hours, to, for example, switch off equipment on our satellites to prevent short-circuiting. Well, but we should not switch our equipment all the time. The satellites, they are not for fun. They should work. We should switch them off only when it is necessary. And to predict when it is necessary, we need to know how intensive is this event that is coming. And this is space weather idea. This is an illustration of these particles and their interaction with Earth magnetosphere. Magnetic field of the Earth protects the planet, does not allow these energetic particles to come directly to the planet. And this is good, but at the same time, the perturbances in magnetic field can create a lot of problems. Because, for example, you can have short circuiting of electric equipment. You can have induction of currents in these cables. You can have disruption of communications between satellites and airplanes. And this is a very, very serious issue. It is estimated that the effect of such events could be cost usually several billions of dollars per year. So because as we have more sensitive equipment in space, it's the price may go up. Well, sometimes we have flares which are unusually bright. For example, a typical solar flare releases 100 million times of the world's consumption of energy. But there can be solar flares much more powerful. One of these, or actually the most powerful recorded solar flare is a so-called Carrington event. At this, when this solar flare happened, it was this aurora was seen near equator. And such an event, if it happens nowadays, can probably destroy most of the equipment on the at the orbit, even if it's switched off. But these are not probably the most dramatic solar flares associated with our sun. For example, the studies of a particular isotope, carbon-14 in Seda, in Japanese Seda, revealed that at that time, probably between 774, 775, there was an event which was 1,000 times more energetic than Carrington event. This such event actually is dangerous not only for electronic equipment, but it's also dangerous for biosphere. And the such solar super flares are observed, in fact, for other stars similar to our sun. If you have a substantial sample of stars and you observe them, from time to time you see such events. Well, let me touch upon a rather sensitive topic, which is the relation of solar activity and climate. Well, solar activity. Formerly, during the solar cycle, as we have change of this number of the sunspots, we have insubstantial change of the solar flux. But because of magnetic activity, we can have a substantial influence on what's happening on the Earth. For example, if we are talking about extreme UV, in this case, the change of the flux of the UV radiation is not 0.1% as in just visible light. But in extreme UV, it can be a substantially larger factor, factor 10 or more. And this can have an appreciable effect on ozone layer. And it's very difficult, actually, to understand the consequences of all these changes. But we know that during flares, you have this change of the concentration of ozone. And it can have different consequences. I will mention one of the consequences, and it's related to La Nina event in the Pacific. It was found that you change substantially precipitation and temperatures in the Pacific region during this solar flares, and this is a result of a complex processes change triggered by changes in the ozone concentration or ozone column densities. Another important event that we know took place in the history is the change in the number of solar spots. As I told you, Galileo was the first who discovered this solar spots. Earlier on, they were also observed in ancient Greece and also in China, but then no one was looking at sun somehow. But Galileo found them. Actually, he was using his telescope, but not his eye. There is a joke that you can watch your sun with your eye, but only twice. Once with your left eye, then with your right eye. So he was not as stupid as that. He was projecting this on a screen and was experimenting. And after that, the number of the sunspot was studied. And we know that there was a period which is called Mount Minimum, during which there were essentially no sunspots. And interestingly enough, this period coincides with the so-called Small Ice Age. This is a picture of Holland. You see, everything is frozen. You go travel to Holland and you'll see it's not nowadays. Well, there was some other period of low solar activity. And this is Napoleon in Russia. The particular winter of 1812 was extremely, extremely cold. We know that Napoleon lost his great army. But it's less known that Russian army lost its nearly all its cavalry and guns because it was so cold. Well, there are scientists who believe that there is quite a relation between the changes of climate and the solar activity. And this is related actually not with the energetic particles of the sun. Sun also emits energetic particles. But it's related to the energetic particles related to the galaxy. What would you say relation of the solar activity and galactic flux? The relation is through the solar wind. There is a wind coming from the sun, and its intensity depends on the solar activity. If you have strong wind, you have a pleiaeon around the solar system, and less cosmic rays are coming from the outside. And less cosmic rays interact with the Earth atmosphere. These people believe that this creates, this is the key to the relation of climate and solar magnetic activity. What's happening? If you have more galactic cosmic rays coming into our atmosphere, this cosmic rays passing through the atmosphere ionize atmosphere. And this creates the seeds for drops of water. creates clouds. And these clouds, when they are at lower atmosphere, reflect solar light. If they are in the upper atmosphere, the effect is opposite. Interestingly, they act more like a blanket, not allowing the Earth to lose its heat. But in the lower atmosphere, they create clouds and decrease the flux of solar radiation towards the Earth. And this is what they show. They show that there is the variation of the galactic flux detected, of course, galactic cosmic flux detected at the Earth, and the cloud, amount of clouds in the atmosphere. They also claim, and this is controversial, I will show some data by other researchers, that you can essentially explain most of the changes of climate by this effect. In terms of the variations of climate, it's also interesting that sometimes these variations of climate are pretty rapid. For example, they can happen in, as here explained, in dozens of years, which somehow acts against a competing theory which tries to explain the variations of climate by the changes of the precession of the Earth or some variations in the Earth orbit. Interestingly enough, these researchers also relate the ice ages to the motion of the solar system within our galaxy. As you know, our galaxy is a spiral galaxy, and as the solar system moves, it will it goes through this through spiral and then space between the spirals. And the intensity of cosmic rays is known to be different in spirals and outside spirals. It's stronger in the spirals. And so this graph shows the intensity of this epochs of glaciation, the periods of ice age on the Earth. Incidentally, we are still living in the ice age, because ice age is defined by the part of Earth history where we have either South Pole or North Pole or both covered with ice. And this relates to the times of this glaciation, and where is the cursor, for example, and the flux of the cosmic rays, which was detected by a particular procedure of studying meteorites. So these people believe that we can explain essentially all the changes of the climate by the flux of cosmic rays, both in the during previous history through millions of years, these are millions of years, and on the time scale of dozens of years and years. So, in fact, in their papers, they say at least two-thirds of the variations of climate of our planet can be explained. Well, this is not an accepted point of view. For example, there are some studies which show that Indeed, if we look at the records of solar activity, these are solar activity averaged over 11-year period, which is the cycle. And this is the temperatures, also average over 11 years. And they say, okay, this is probably not bad correlation between these activities up to maybe 1960, even maybe further. But later, we see a decorrelation between this. So the present warming is not due to the cosmic rays, and it's probably we humans are responsible. Well, accepting this, the authors of the theory that I showed you do not agree. They have their different data, and I will not go into all these details. But what I believe still is not controversial is that there is still correlation. For earlier, maybe now it's not correlated. We emitting too much of this greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, but we could not probably deny the fact that there is correlation between these activities. And also, I showed you this plots of the clouds and cosmic rays, and these are also plots from people who argue against this, at least present correlation. They say, no, there is no correlation right now. But nevertheless, for a substantial period, you see this correlation. So I think it is difficult to deny that this is an important fact and it's an important process to study. And this is related to magnetic activity. Well, if we think about climate variations, it's really interesting. We see really big changes of the climate. And irrespectively what is happening now, it's a big scientific problem to understand why we had these big variations of climate through the history. Well, let me change the gear and discuss something different, but still magnetic. And this is related to pulses. Our sun is a magnetic star, but there are stars which are much more magnetic. In some sense, pulses cannot be called stars. It should be called corpses of stars. Because these are the objects which are created during the death of the stars, when a star dies producing a supernova. Interestingly enough that this objects show very strong magnetism. And they are observed because it's magnetism. So we have a neutron star. This is a probably 10 kilometer object with a mass higher than the solar mass. And all the matter is compressed into neutrons. So electrons are squeezed into the nucleus, and everything forms neutrons. And there are currents in such a system which create magnetic field, and there is beam radiation along the magnetic axis of such a star. And as this neutron star rotates, from time to time, this beam will be pointing towards our planet, and we'll see. These are pulses. There are, in fact, more magnetized objects than pulses, and they are called magnetars. In this object, the magnetic forces are comparable with the gravitational forces, which actually squeeze electrons into nucleus. So these are really remarkable objects, and we have some evidence of their existence. Interestingly enough, I showed you the solar activity in terms of the solar flares. Now we believe that similar to solar flares, we can have flares on magnetars. And it is also believed that the processes similar to solar flares may be the source of gamma ray bursts. These are the most energetic events in the present universe. In fact, if a similar gamma ray burst happens somewhere in the vicinity of the star, our sun, meaning in the vicinity, in galactic vicinity, we would be completely exterminated. There is no way to be saved. Well, I talked about the corpses of the stars. What about young stars? Young stars also show a lot of magnetic activity. In particular, young stars show jets. And jets ubiquitous phenomenon for different objects. It's somehow related to the processes of accretion. And accretion is also a magnetized process. And when you accrete material, part of this material will be ejected along these jets. And these jets can be collimated. And they can be collimated, for example, for galactic jets over the distance of many dozens and sometimes hundreds of light years. They are collimated, they are directed, and magnetic fields are responsible for this. So we have many magnetic processes also happening on the scale of the galaxies. And even our galaxy is something that we still need to understand. Interestingly enough, the particular event or particular phenomenon of really gigantic proportions was discovered quite recently, and it's called Fermi bubble because it was discovered with the Fermi satellite. This is a picture of representation of our galaxy, and this is the cloud of magnetized plasma that was discovered. And you see, this cloud is comparable to our galaxy. So I touched upon, in my lecture, different phenomena on different scales. And we are discovering more and more magnetic phenomena in astrophysics. Let me, just in the last couple of minutes, mention, for example, what I'm doing in relation to this big picture. What I'm doing is related to the process of annihilation of magnetic fields. So we may have magnetic fields of different direction. And when they are frozen in plasma, they have their own life. And if these magnetic fields of different direction come together, they reconnect. This is the source of energy for solar flares, for all these magnetic processes that I was describing. Interestingly enough, the process of reconnection is still mysterious. We don't have good, well, it's not agreed upon, I would put it this way. What is the process which makes the connection fast? Interestingly enough, to explain solar flares, it's not enough to have a connection fast. It also should be slow. So look how mysterious is it. Sometimes it's fast, sometimes it's slow. Why it should be slow? Because we know that accumulation of the magnetic flux for the solar flares happening for weeks. And magnetic fields, in this case, are in contact. And they are reconnecting probably very slowly. And then suddenly they start reconnecting fast. So with my collaborator, we suggested a particular model which of a connection which develops the classical textbook model of the process. This upper panel shows this classical model of a connection. It's called Sweet-Parker connection after the researchers who introduced this model. This is the model in which you have magnetic fluxes in the opposite direction and plasma, which is coming in the vertical direction, is being ejected from this slot of the size delta in the horizontal direction. And you have the annihilation of magnetic field in this region. What's the problem with this model? It can explain slow reconnection, but it cannot explain fast reconnection. Why? Because if you think about this, what is this scale? This is the scale of your magnetic flux tubes. And this is astrophysical scale, big scale. And what is the other scale? The other scale is microphysical. It's determined by your plasma properties. And this disparity of the scale makes, through the conservation of your matter, a connection velocity slow. It's the velocity of the ejection of the material times a very small factor. Well, what we suggested? We suggested to add a natural phenomenon, which we know exists in nature, which is turbulence. The real plasma is not calm. When we observe solar flares, we see turbulent motions, turbulent plasma. Actually, air in this room is also turbulent. Blood in your big vessels is also turbulent. Turbulence is everywhere. And the larger the scale, the more turbulent phenomena we see. We added this, and because of that, we managed to explain the processes of fast reconnection. Because when you have turbulence, you can have much larger outflow velocity. And in some sense, this is very natural process. Turbulence is known to accelerate processes of, for example, mixing. If you rely on a simple process of molecular diffusion, you would need 4 months for your coffee to become sweet. You don't wait 4 months. You just mix the coffee, you create turbulence, and that's it. So, okay, I can show you also, as the final note, some simulations of this turbulent A connection. And this shows turbulence naturally developing when we bring magnetic fluxes, but use very big boxes. So this was testing of our idea. And you see this development of turbulence and enhancement of A connection, which is related to it. What we see actually, and this is interesting, such patterns sometimes you see in the sky with clouds. This is Kelvin-Helmholtz instability. We also see this instability in this turbulent layers. I don't have time to describe you the consequences of this fast A connection, and we suggested a new theory of star formation related to this fast A connection, and also provided an explanation of anomalous cosmic rays which were detected by Voyagers. Well, this is probably the subject of more specialized lectures. I can answer your questions if you have. But for the time being, thank you for your attention, and I will be happy to answer your question. Thank you.